It is my pleasure to introduce our first speaker, Dr. Frank Rossi, an associate professor in the horticulture section of the School of Integrative Plant Science at Cornell University. Frank is a world-renowned expert on turfgrass, so you're getting the best of the best today, whether it's lawns, golf courses, or sports turf. And for our segment today, Frank will talk about fall lawn IPM, managing leaves and ticks. So Frank, you can take it away.
Thank you very much for having me. Hi to Amara. Thank you both for doing this and for all of you taking time out of your schedule to spend a half an hour chatting about lawns. And I'm very excited to do it because this is the best time of year to be talking about lawns. There are so many things you can be doing at this time of year that really benefit you the whole next year, that I always am really sad that the lawn business got moved as a spring thing, when in fact for us, fall is a much better time to do it. Okay, so why is fall good for grasses and lawns and turf grass areas? The days are still long, so you get a lot of sunlight, good for photosynthesis. Cool nights, which means a lot of plants will begin to store energy at that time of year with the cooler night conditions. They'll put reserves into root systems. And generally, there's adequate moisture that will give you some actual growth again, a little bit of a growth spurt on the other side of an otherwise dry summer period. And here's what I know. This slide, I think I got it 30 years ago when I started, and I've loved it ever since. It's a really good example of the way your lawn, if it's mostly cool season grasses, grows. Even if it's 50% cool season grasses, at least half the plants have a surge of growth in the spring, a slowing of growth in the summer as temperatures rise, both air and soil temperatures. And then as we return to these conditions in the fall from the, you know, like spring-like conditions, where it is still long days, the days are getting longer, temperatures are still cool, and there's plenty of moisture in the spring. What you notice is plants, generally grasses, don't surge as much with their top growth in the fall that they do in the spring. You see a lot more leaf growth in the spring, a lot less in the fall. So when you do things in the fall, particularly nutritionally, to try to help your lawn get thick, maybe to keep weeds out or help your lawn just perform better with less resources, mow it less. Applying nitrogen at this time of year is a really critical part of a good lawn management program. If you are unhappy and want to have your lawn sort of be more competitive for plants you don't want growing there, maybe you have, you know, folks using your lawn, lots of traffic, and it needs to regrow more. Maybe the kids are using it. Maybe your dogs are using it. This is a good time of year to build more root growth that then helps you next summer when it comes to surviving drier conditions. So it's optimum time for feeding, for controlling weeds, and seeding. So I'm just going to take a minute before I get to the leaf conversation. So I always like to throw this in because we used to say something different than this. We used to say, fertilize as late as you can. Go into Thanksgiving, right when top growth stops, put the nitrogen on because it'll be really good for the plant next spring. It won't grow as much. The roots will be deep. But what we found, and so first thing you ought to understand is how does nitrogen move into a plant? Now, this may be deeper than you thought we were going to get, but it moves with the water. Nitrogen moves with water into the plant and out through evapotranspiration. That's nitrogen. That's how it moves through plants and especially through grasses. And the problem is at this time of year, we don't get a lot of evapotranspiration. The sun is lower in the sky. So not a lot of nitrogen is moving in the water to the plant. So what's happening? Well, this is some data from a research project in Connecticut, Carl Guillard, the former soil scientist in the turfgrass program. If you look at this, this is cumulative amount of nitrogen that leaches from the soil when you apply fertilizer at September, October, November, or December. So this is over a three-year period looking at the cumulative nitrogen losses from applying 1 pound of nitrogen at these different times. And what you can see is very clearly, the later you apply, the more nitrogen leaks out. So what we've done a lot of research doing is finding these periods of time where you'll get the least amount of leaching of the nitrogen that you apply, and also lowering the rate. So here's the summary of this. We used to say go really late. Now we want you to be between the middle of October and the end of October, and no more than about a half a pound of actual soluble nitrogen. Some of it could be slow release nitrogen, but generally you want to get it down while the plants can still take it up to help water quality. Just a note about fall weed control. These perennial broadleaf weeds, dandelion, clover, those are the two biggies, plantain, ground ivy, all much more effectively controlled at this time of year than in the springtime or than in the summer. This is the time when if you use or spot treat with an herbicide, even a organic herbicide, knocking the plants back now will generally allow the winter to do its job and reduce our weed population next spring. And if you'd like more information about weed ID, we have a really good resource for weed identification. Finally, it's a really good time for seeding because you got really good soil temperatures, adequate moisture. But the single most important thing is you generally have many fewer weeds competing with the grasses at this time of year. So you still have a few more weeks where we think you could get some grasses established in bare areas that might get filled with weeds. And then finally, I'd be remiss if I left out my insect conversation and my colleague Kyle Wicking's grub identification program, because we have seen some of the most aggressive skunk damage at our research center than we've seen in many, many years. So I don't know if that's what's happening out there, but this is the time when we're going to see it. We're seeing grubs generally a little bit younger than we would normally see them at this time of year. Because of the dry period, it's possible egg laying by many of these species was delayed. I try not to go too deep in entomology. This is the one lane that is I don't have a lot of pavement on this lane in my expertise. That's why I make good friends with guys like Matt Fry and Jody to make sure I know what I'm talking about. Thanks, Matt. Anyway, let's talk about leaves. Let's start out with some simple stuff about tree leaves in the urban environment. First off, about 13% of the nation's solid waste is leaves and other yard debris. So that should get your attention right out of the gate. It also costs communities a fair amount of money to collect the leaves, about $1,000 per curb mile. And this is from data back in 2013-14. So you'd expect this to be even larger. When I did a cursory survey of some suburban areas of Westchester County, multiple million dollars of money they spend to collect leaves each fall. Okay, so what to do with this stuff, right? Here are these tree leaves that fall in our landscape, and we want to know what to do with them. So first, let's look at another environmental problem. Trees in urban environments certainly provide a cooling benefit. No one would argue that. But when it comes to water quality issues, right, streets and paved surfaces that funnel water and pollutants into storm drains add a significant amount to the water quality problems, right? If you look at this graph on the right here, you see a clear relationship between the percentage of the canopy, the street canopy covered by trees, and the amount of total phosphorus associated with the stormwater, right? So this is another reason to keep the leaves off the street, right? And be mindful of our organic waste. So many years ago, turf grass scientists started studying this issue. And there are some studies now that have been going on for close to 20 years, looking at various aspects of the soil and what happens to the lawn. Now, first off, the question we always get is, well, when you mulch leaves into a lawn, it must screw up the soil. It must change the pH. It must alter the nutrients. And the fact is, from this study in 2002, after about 10 years of doing this, they did not find a significant impact on mulching tree leaves into the soil routinely with a lawn on it, right? Now, how did the lawn do? Well, in general, it looks like, you know, oak leaves did a little bit better as far as how the lawn looked. No mulching seemed to not do as well. And again, this is after 10 years of doing tree leaves on your lawn. Now, how, you know, obviously one of the things is that tree leaves don't all fall at the same time. And you have to have a lawn that's thick enough to receive them, like a shag carpet. So a lot of people are lowering their lawn height at this time of year, so the leaves blow onto their neighbor's lawn. I actually suggest maybe you raise the height so that you've got opportunity and places to put the leaves into the lawn canopy. And this is some data that shows two different mowing heights. What did the visible litter look like the following spring, right? Following this amount of tree leaf deposition. So the 450 pound per thousand is about 2x of normal leaf drop. Normal leaf drop, or 1.5x. Normal leaf drop is about 300 pounds per thousand square feet of the tree leaves that were studied in the oak maple lawn work that they did here. So you can see the lower you cut it, the more debris you have, the more leaves you have, the more debris you have. I mean, obviously not rocket science. The other interesting thing they saw was a little bit of a difference, not statistical, but numerical, a little bit of a difference in how the lawn greened up in the springtime. Again, after 10 years of looking at it. The other thing that was fascinating is they actually measured a slight reduction in dandelion population where they mulched the tree leaves. Now, it was very little, 30%. But if you're doing this and you're thinking about an IPM program for things like dandelion, obviously 30% is a contributing amount, a measurable amount, a significant difference, and maybe also contributing to using less chemicals if you want a more weed-free lawn. Now, let's get to the pest of the hour, the tick. So again, I'm going to rely on people that know more about ticks than I do. So I'm going to give Joellen the credit or the blame for how much I actually know about this stuff, because I talk about it with her weekly on our conference call that we do at Lawn. So if you went to the CDC website and you wanted to know about what you should do to reduce black-legged ticks in your yard, you would come to a page that looked like this, that would recommend this very classic document done back in 2005 or 7 about tick management handbook, where they originally began to suggest mowed lawns are not habitats for these pests, but it appears that the edges of these forested tree lawn landscapes are places where some of these things can occur. Now, this has been substantiated in a number of studies. This is back in 1995. Terry Schultz apparently is a regular contributor to this literature, as I'll talk again in a minute. But in this article, you see a removal of leaf litter in wooded areas of a forested community reduce the abundance of questing black-legged ticks. Okay, well, I don't know how many people going into the woods to do this, but obviously there is data to suggest that for this particular species, reducing the leaf population in the forest is one way to do it. I'm not sure how practical that is. Here is another article that was published very recently looking at tick-borne pathogen spillover into urban yards. And this particular work happened in Staten Island, right? This work was published recently on Staten Island, and their conclusion was essentially similar in the sense that, you know, Ixodes, I think this is the black-legged tick, and I don't know what this Amblyomma is, but it seemed to work for reducing the canopy cover, reduce the population of, or help predict the presence of these, but not this other tick. There's a considerable risk exposure in residential islands. Again, particularly significance of log and brush piles for all the three species support recommendations for yard management of reducing contact with ticks. So either it's leaf debris or wood debris, it appears there are some direct relationships between these ticks, some multiple species here, and yard management tactics. Finally, was this work that Terry did in 2020, looking at accumulating leaf litter along the forest edge. And again, you know, you see these, you've got sample sites in the forest, around the lawn, right? And again, when you looked at tick populations, total daily nymphs in these areas where they blew the leaves to, like many landscape managers will do, where they blew the leaves to is where the highest populations of these nymphs were found in the study that they conducted. So I think it's a fairly clear line, at least as far as we know. I wouldn't say you're not going to get ticks in mowed areas, managed lawn areas, but it's certainly there's a consistency in the literature that these edge effects, whether we create them through our management practices or they deliberately happen. In this case, you see the natural edge is not as loaded with these nymphs as the edge where you're managing it by blowing the leaves there. So again, mulch the leaves in. We have no compelling evidence that I've seen that mulching tree leaves into the lawn necessarily increases that population. So I would leave with that particular comment. And I think there are a lot of options that people look into, but I think when you look at the literature, and I'm happy to discuss this with everybody, I don't see anything. I would never assume no risk, but it looks like the traditional sorts of lawn practices that we employ certainly keep some populations of some ticks to a minimum. So Matt, that's what I had as far as my presentation. You said to leave some time for questions. So that's what I did. I don't need to share anymore. We can look at each other. And let me know. I wasn't following the questions. So do you want to lead me through them?
Yeah, sure. So the first one that came up was with the drought this past summer, is it still a good time to do fall grass planting this year? Or is it better to wait until spring?
No. Well, it's getting late. The drought this year, if you've benefited, like much of the Northeast has over the last several weeks, from routine rain, I would say it's depending on where you are in the state, the further south you are, the more time you have, the further north you are, the less time you have. I'd say you're close to done up in the Adirondacks. And I think you're right in the middle of it here in central New York, and you probably still have another month anyway down in the New York metropolitan area. To get some seed in and down and established, it's really good, especially if you've got bare areas that are likely to fill in with plants you don't want.
Excellent.
All right.
The second question that came in was about balancing the amount of leaf litter as cover for things like beneficial insects and bumblebees. So in those areas, you wouldn't necessarily want to mulch. You'd want the full leaf. So what kind of approach would you take to balance having that leaf litter and also, mitigating the other effects that you talked about?
Okay. I didn't hear the first part of the comment, Matt.
Yeah. So the question was about preserving some of those areas that you want to have a layer of actual leaf litter for protection for beneficial insects.
Oh, right. Yeah. I don't know. I mean, that is the conundrum, right? Isn't that the conundrum? Because I hear this often from Jen, a learner, and also Joellen, that debris is really important for pollinator habitat. And I guess I would defer. I see Joellen is here. Maybe Jen Lerner is here. I can't speak to that directly, whether that, how to deal with that, but it feels like a conundrum. What do you think, Joellen?
I can jump in too, Frank.
Go ahead. Go ahead, Amar. Yeah, go ahead.
So Joellen may have more expertise to share on this as well. My suggestion to people is generally to not let the perfect become the enemy of the good. So if you want to pick some parts of your yard to leave the leaves to, support bumblebees and fireflies, go for it. Don't feel like you have to do it with your whole entire yard. Do you have some more input to add, Joellen?
My understanding from that project that you mentioned, Frank, about the artificial accumulation was exactly on that, the artificial accumulation. So when the leaves were just left there at its natural level, we did not see that accumulation of ticks. It was when people were blowing in and the leaves were accumulating at the edge that we saw that large increase.
Beautiful. Beautiful. Beautiful.
Any other questions for Frank? So there were some questions that were answered, some links that were shared. question here. So this is a little bit outside of the lawn, but do ticks hide in pachysandra patches? And so Joellen is shaking her head yes on that one.
I found them in pachysandra patches, yes.
Yes. So great. This, you know, this session, Frank jam-packed a lot of great information in there. I learned some things that I'm certainly going to apply at home. Please remember to view the recording and share that with your friends and family so that they can implement some of these techniques. So we'll thank Frank for his excellent presentation, and we'll transition now to Amara's presentation. So everyone on this call is probably familiar with Amara as the co-host of this event, and she is the biocontrol specialist at the New York State IPM program. And so her presentation today is going to address the question, is that a praying mantis egg mass? So Amara, you can take it away.
All right. Thank you, Matt. So just really quick, short bit of information for you related to IPM and praying mantids or praying mantises. No judgment, whichever form of the plural you like to use. So some quick facts about praying mantids or praying mantises. These are generalist predators. Most people recognize that. They recognize that these are good bugs, beneficial insects that you want around your garden. They are, as generalist predators, they will feed on a huge range of things, all sorts of insects, both pests and beneficial insects, so bees, butterflies, but they'll even eat small birds. I've seen some really kind of sad pictures of praying mantises eating hummingbirds. So just recognize that these insects, like many parts of our ecosystem, they may not always be eating the things that you wish they would eat. And partly as a result of that, there are variety of experts who will tell you, you know what, sure, they're good bugs to have in your garden, but they're not something that you're like, oh, I need to have lots of praying mantises because they're going to solve all of my pest problems. It's more complicated than that. Most of the species of praying mantis that you will encounter here in New York State are not native, so that's another interesting fact. And these insects will have just one generation per year here, and they'll lay eggs in the fall. Which is one reason we scheduled this talk for this time of year, because you might be finding some of these egg masses. So this is what praying mantis egg masses look like. They get laid on all sorts of surfaces, anything from, this is a young Christmas tree trunk. You can see the egg mass here. This egg mass was just laid on a piece of grass in the fall. I took this picture in the spring. You could still see it there. They tend to be anywhere from an inch to a couple inches long. Here's another one that I found laid kind of on a window well of a basement window on my house. So that you can find them in all sorts of places. They're really interesting looking. And so if you find one of these around where you live, where you're working, just know that this is what it is. It's not something you need to be worried about. So what should you do if you find a praying mantis egg case? Probably the best advice is just leave it alone. These insects, this is how they naturally reproduce. They lay their eggs in the wintertime. The egg masses will hang out over the winter. They'll hatch in the spring when the temperature gets to be right. And you could have some praying mantises in your yard. If you really have a desire to see them hatch, which can be kind of cool, so this picture here is showing a jar that is full of baby praying mantids that had been brought inside as an egg mass. If you do want to try this, the thing to do would be to keep the egg mass at a cool temperature over the winter. So don't bring it into the house, leave it in an unheated garage or in an unheated porch. If you bring it in over the winter, the eggs might hatch too soon, and then you're going to have a bunch of praying mantids and it's too cold to release them outside. If you keep it in a cool place over the winter time, you could bring it inside where it's warmer around mid-May and then watch to see if the eggs hatch. Not all egg cases will produce viable praying mantids, but it can be a fun thing to see. When they do hatch, you want to make sure that you release them within about a day or so. Release them outside, in your garden, in your yard. If you leave them too long in the jar, they will start to eat each other, which is another good reason not to try to hatch them inside too early, because you probably don't want to be feeding praying mantises all winter long. So that is all I have for you today. If you do find some praying mantis egg cases, we would love to see pictures of them. You can send them to our What's Bugging You First Friday photo contest. And the link was shared in the chat earlier about how to do that. And that's all I have.
Great. Thanks, Amara. We did have one question that came in, and it was what species of praying mantis is native to the U.S. and New York? And I just put in the chat that the Carolina mantid is the one that is native. I think it is more of a southern species, but it can be found in New York and most of the Northeast as well. So thank you, everybody, for attending. Next month, we're going to be having a conversation about deer damage. And this is a timely topic because a lot of people are starting to see deer browse on their ornamental plants around their yard. So we'll hear from Dr. Paul Curtis on reducing some of that damage. And we will also hear another great presentation by Amara. So thank you, everybody, for your attendance today. And we hope you plan to join us for a future First Friday event. Have a good weekend.